Please be seated. A reading from Exodus chapter 20, verses 1 through 17. And God spoke all these words, saying, I am the Lord your God who brought you out of the land of Egypt, out of the house of slavery. You shall have no other gods before me. You shall not make for yourself a carved image or any likeness of anything that is in heaven above, or that is in the earth beneath, or that is in the water under the earth. You shall not bow down to them or serve them, for I, the Lord your God, am a jealous God, visiting the iniquity of the fathers on the children for the third and the fourth generation to those who hate me, but showing steadfast love to thousands of those who love me and keep my commandments. You shall not take the name of the Lord your God in vain, for the Lord will not hold him guiltless who takes his name in vain. Remember the Sabbath day to keep it holy. 6 days you shall labor and do all your work, but the seventh day is a Sabbath to the Lord your God. On it you shall not do any work, you or your son or your daughter, your male servant or your female servant, or your livestock, or the sojourner that is within your gates. For in 6 days the Lord made heaven and earth, the sea and all that is in them, and rested on the seventh day. Therefore the Lord blessed the Sabbath day and made it holy. Honor your father and mother, that your days may be long in the land that the Lord your God is giving to you. You shall not murder. You shall not commit adultery. You shall not steal. You shall not bear false witness against your neighbor. You shall not covet your neighbor's house. You shall not covet your neighbor's wife, or his male servant, or his female servant, or his ox, his donkey, or anything that is your neighbor's. Please stand as you are able as we read Psalm 116 responsively. I love the Lord because he has heard the voice of my prayer.
Because
he inclined his ear to me, therefore will I call upon him as long as I live. The snares of death encompassed me, and the pains of the grave laid hold of me. I suffered trouble and sorrow.
Then I called upon the name of the Lord. O Lord, save me.
Gracious is the Lord and righteous. Indeed, our God is full of compassion.
The Lord preserves the simple. I was in misery, and he helped me.
Turn again to your rest, O my soul, for the Lord has rewarded you.
You have delivered my soul from death, my eyes from tears, and my feet from stumbling, that I may walk before the Lord in the land of the living.
Please be seated.
A reading from the Gospel of John, chapter 13, verses 31 through 35. When he had gone out, Jesus said, Now is the Son of Man glorified, and God is glorified in him. If God is glorified in him, God will also glorify him in himself and glorify him at once. Little children, yet a little while I am with you. You will seek me, and just as I said to the Jews, so now I also say to you, where I am going, you cannot come. A new commandment I give to you, that you love one another, just as I have loved you. You also are to love one another. By this, all people will know that you are my disciples, if you have love for one another. On the night that Jesus was betrayed, he washed his disciples' feet. Peter refused to allow the Lord to do so, but Jesus said to him, Unless I wash your feet, you have no part of me. Peter then said, Then, Lord, wash not only my feet, but my whole body as well. With humility, we come before the Lord, confessing that we have not loved one another as he has commanded, and asking him to cleanse us from our sin. Let us first confess our sins silently, and then we'll confess in unison using the confession of sin written in your bulletin. Let's pray. Let's pray together the prayer in the bulletin. Lord God, eternal and almighty Father, we acknowledge before your holy majesty that we are poor sinners, conceived and born in guilt and in corruption, prone to do evil, unable of our own power to do good. Because of our sin, we endlessly violate your holy commandments. But, O Lord, with heartfelt sorrow, we repent and turn away from all our offenses. We condemn ourselves in our evil ways, with true sorrow, asking that your grace will relieve our distress. Have compassion on us, most gracious God, Father of mercies, for the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, your Holy Spirit. And in removing our guilt, also grant us daily increase of the grace of your Holy Spirit, and produce in us the fruits of holiness and of righteousness pleasing in your sight. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Amen. Brothers and sisters, our sin is great, but God's grace and mercy is greater. In 1 John, God tells us that if we confess our sins, he is faithful and just to forgive us. We can be confident in the work that the Lord has done.
A reading from Exodus 12, 1 through 4, and 11 through 14. The Lord said to Moses and Aaron in the land of Egypt, "This month shall be for you the beginning of months. It shall be the first month of the year for you. Tell all the congregation of Israel that on the 10th day of this month, every man shall take a lamb according to their father's houses, a lamb for a household. And if the household is too small for a lamb, then he and his nearest neighbor shall take according to the number of persons, according to what each can eat, you shall make your count for the lamb. In this manner you shall eat it, with your belt fastened, your sandals on your feet, and your staff in your hand, and you shall eat it in haste. It is the Lord's Passover, for I will pass through the land of Egypt that night, and I will strike all the firstborn in the land of Egypt, both man and beast, and on all the gods of Egypt I will execute judgments. I am the Lord. This blood shall be a sign for you on the houses where you are, and when I see the blood, I will pass over you, and no plague will befall you to destroy you when I strike the land of Egypt. This day shall be for you a memorial day, and you shall keep it as a feast to the Lord throughout your generations, as a statute forever. You shall keep it as a feast." The word of the Lord.
Good evening. I'd like us to move into a time of prayer together, corporate prayer, and I invite you to pray out loud with us. I'll use an acronym that you are probably familiar with to move us through sections of prayer, acts. First we'll pray prayers of adoration, praise to God, expressing our praise to him for who he is. Then we'll move into confession, sharing with God our sorrow for the sins of our nation, the sins of the world, the sins of our church, or the sins of ourselves. Then we'll move to thanksgiving, T, and thanking God for what he has done in our lives. And then finally, we will close with a section on supplication, asking God to bless the world, bless our nation, bless our area and our church, and raising up people who are on your heart to pray for. If you are so led to pray out loud, I just ask three things. First, pray loudly so others can hear what you're praying. We know the Lord can hear it, but pray loudly so others can hear as well and agree with you and pray for those things silently along with you. Secondly, if you pray out loud, pray in a short manner, one sentence, two sentences or so, just a direct statement of what is on your heart to the Lord. So that gives opportunity for many people to pray. And the last thing I'd ask that is if you pray out loud, that you would end your prayer by saying, in the name of Jesus. And that will help others know that you're done praying. And when you say, in the name of Jesus, I'd ask everyone to say, amen. And that would open up the opportunity for someone else to pray at that point. So let's turn our hearts to the Lord in prayer now as a congregation. Lord, we praise you. Oh, how our soul praises you. All our inmost being praises your holy name. The hosts of heaven right now are singing holy, 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 and praising your name. And so we come before you right now to praise you for who you are. Hear our prayers, we ask.
Father, for loving us and for calling us back to yourself, for redeeming us, we give you praise in the name of Jesus.
Amen. Amen. Lord, we come before you knowing that you have redeemed our life from the pit, and that pit is representative of the sin in our lives. Lord, you are slow to anger, you are abounding in love, but we come before you, a holy God, knowing our deficiencies, our weakness, our rejection of you in our lives. Doing what is good and what is right, doing the things we ought not to do, and not doing the things that we ought to do. And Lord, we come before you humbly, confessing our sin to you now.
forgive the world for the atrocities that it commits against each other and against you. In the name of Jesus.
Amen.
Lord, our sin is great, but you forgive us. In the name of Jesus.
Amen.
Lord, for the divine humility of becoming human, sacrificing yourself in the understanding the depth of pain and despair in humanity and what you created, we thank you and bless you. In the name of Jesus.
Amen.
For all the times where we failed, because you've shown us time and time again how to forgive. Thank you for showing us that. In the name of Jesus.
Amen.
And Lord, as far as the east is from the west, you have cast that sin from us. And as a father has compassion on his children, Lord, you have compassion on us. And you renew our youth like the eagles. You've made your ways known to us. You do not treat us as our sins deserve. So, Lord, we thank you. We rejoice in your presence this day. Hear our prayers of thanksgiving to you now.
Amen.
Thank you for all the blessings you send our way. In Jesus' name.
Amen.
We thank you for your grace, never ending. In Jesus' name.
Amen.
Father, we thank you for our families and our friends and our children and the wonderful relationships and love there. In the name of Jesus.
Amen.
Father, we thank you for always loving us, no matter what. In the name of Jesus.
Amen.
Father, we thank you for the ministers here at Triangle Grace Church. In Jesus' name.
Amen.
Lord, you have knit us together as a body, and we're thankful for that, for the family that you've given us to live out our lives together, depend upon each other, and to rejoice in your presence as children, brothers and sisters with our Lord Jesus Christ. And we pray for those among us who are sick, who are heavy laden, who need your encouragement and hope. We pray for this world, and Lord, hear our prayers of supplication now.
Lord, please continue to pour out your Spirit on this sin-sick world and heal us and save us. In the name of Jesus.
Amen.
Amen.
For healing for those who struggle with cancer, for Meredith and for Donna and for so many, you know their names, God, in the name of Jesus.
Amen.
Father, I ask you to comfort those who are dealing with bodily ailments. I know you are the great physician. You're able to heal anything and everything. In the name of Jesus.
Who are lost, Father God, we just pray that they will hear your gospel message and come to faith in Christ. In Jesus' name.
Amen.
Lord, we Thank you for the gift of prayer, that you do not leave us alone, but by your Spirit, he groans for us, even the prayers that we do not know we need to pray before your throne. And Lord, you gather every tear there that we cry. And Lord, we thank you for the example of prayer that your Son has taught us to pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Thank you. A reading from the Gospel of Luke, chapter 22, verses 14 to 23. And when the hour came, he reclined at table, and the apostles with him. And he said to them, I have earnestly desired to eat this Passover with you before I suffer. For I tell you, I will not eat it until it is fulfilled in the kingdom of God. And he took a cup, and when he had given thanks, he said, take this and divide it among yourselves. For I tell you that from now on, I will not drink of the fruit of the vine until the kingdom of God comes. And he took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and gave it to them, saying, this is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me. And likewise, the cup, after they had eaten, saying, this cup is poured out for you. This cup that is poured out for you is the new covenant in my blood. But behold, the hand of him who betrays me is with me on that table. For the Son of Man goes as it has been determined, but woe to that man by whom he is betrayed. And they began to question one another which of them it could be who was going to do this. The word of the Lord.
As we gather on this special night, I would like to invite everyone to pause, to reflect on God's goodness. Let us remember that He blesses us over and over again. Thanks be to God. God has blessed me in many ways. One way God has blessed me is through this church. And I know we all can share that same blessing together. God has brought us together to live life together, to pursue Him because He first pursued us. There is one thing that I wish we could change about our church. When I'm coming from the east and traveling down and turning left from Highway 54 into Tudor Place, I don't know if you can relate to me, but when I turn left coming into the church, I'm always looking more back in my rearview mirror. And I'm saying a quick prayer, hoping the car behind me knows to slow down. Can you relate? Yes. With this hill and the curve and the location of our church at the hill and the curve, it's a little hard to see what's happening in front of you. I wish we had a sign. Chris, we need a big sign, a neon sign that can be seen at the top of the hill, before the curve, telling everyone that there's something ahead of you. As we look at Scripture tonight, let us start in the Old Testament. In Exodus chapter 3, God initiates a specific sign for Moses. God communicates to Moses, I have a plan. What a message that is. The God of the universe telling this one man, Moses, that he, God, has a plan. At a burning bush, God tells Moses, I have observed, I have heard the cry of my people. And then God tells Moses that he will deliver them. God hears, God responds, and he delivers. That was true in Exodus, and that is still our story today. Amen. God sends Moses to Pharaoh. What an impossible task. But God says to Moses, I will give you an assurance that my presence will be with you, and that my presence will be with you is a sign for you. Scripture tells us a sign that God is the one who did the sending is that God's presence will be with Moses. Thank you, God, for the gift, for the sign of your presence with Moses. In Exodus chapter 12, God said, the blood of the lamb without blemish shall be put on your doorpost, and this shall be a sign for you. Talk about a neon sign. Can you think of people spreading the blood of the lamb around their doorposts? I think that would stand out just a little bit. And then God told the people, I shall pass over the houses that have this sign on them. Those who respond with this sign, they're showing me that they are mine and I am theirs. They shall be rescued. Let us pray. Lord Jesus, you are the living bread that came down from heaven so that we may live forever with you. We rejoice, for you are our loving Savior. We celebrate the truth that your word is firmly fixed in heaven and your faithfulness endures to all generations. Bless us this day as we worship you and hear the good news from your Spirit, from your word, with your presence with us. It is in the name that is above all names, Jesus, that we pray with thanksgiving. Amen. I truly enjoy teaching confirmation class. It's one of my joys that I get to do every year. This coming Sunday on Easter, we're going to have four youths who just finished confirmation class. They're going to stand before you and answer membership questions with the hope that they'll say yes and become members of the church. During confirmation class, we go through a lot of information, including the fact that we in the Presbyterian Church celebrate two sacraments. I'm confident right now that I could call on Ella, Julianne, Natalie, Alex, or any of the youth, present or former. I could call on them, and they could be able to talk to us about the Lord's Supper. Don't worry, I'm not going to do that. I see some of you. But I will say this. I'm proud of you all because I know your heart and I know you love God. And I know God loves you all. In confirmation class, we talk about that the Lord's Supper is a sign and a seal of God's great love for us. Like the big neon sign on top of the hill before we turn into church, the Lord's Supper is a sign from God that points to what we cannot see. The Lord's Supper is an outward sign of God's invisible grace, an outward sign of God's invisible grace. The Lord's Supper is a seal pointing to the truth that we are marked and sealed because we are God's children. We will be rescued by him. In the Gospel of Luke, chapter 22, verse 8, Jesus told Peter and John, he said, "You go ahead, go and prepare the Passover for us that we may eat it." Scripture tells us, as they go ahead, "Behold, you will have entered the city, and a man carrying a jar of water will meet you." Scripture goes on to tell us, "This man will show you a large upper room furnished. Prepare the Passover there." And they went, and they did as Jesus said. Then Jesus took his place at the table. Jesus speaks in Luke 22, 15. He says, I have genuinely longed for what? Jesus says, to eat this Passover with you before I suffer. The disciples, they prepared the time-honored meal. And here, now Jesus is purposely calling it the Passover, this Passover. By saying this Passover, he's connecting it with Exodus, the past. Jesus is remembering the history of the Exodus when the people were sealed with a sign from the unblemished lamb's blood around the door of the house. God's angels passes over those that are marked with this sign of purity. Now in Luke 22, 16, we see in Scripture Jesus changes. He connects this same Passover with the future. Jesus says, I will not eat it until it is fulfilled in the kingdom of God. Then Jesus takes a cup and he says, take this and divide it among yourselves. Can you picture this in your mind? In the upper room, you and Jesus, the disciples, passing the cup around the table. In Luke 22, 18, once again, Jesus uses future tense. Jesus says, for I will tell you that from now on, I will not drink of the fruit of the vine until the kingdom of God comes. In both of these statements, Jesus is referring to the kingdom of God. Very purposefully, Jesus is saying, God is king. God is powerful. God is sovereign. Jesus is looking into the future where he sees that he is with the Father in the kingdom of God. Jesus knows he is already victorious even before he takes the cup or before he takes the bread. God reigns eternally, even now as they take this Passover meal together. God is still sovereign. In Luke 22, 17, Jesus took a cup and he gives thanks. Again, in Luke 22, 19, he took the bread, and when he had given thanks, this passage of Scripture really stands out to me. Jesus at the table with his disciples, he's taking Passover meal, and he's praying to God the Father. He's thanking God the Father for this cup, for this bread, and for what it means. Jesus prays with thanksgiving. In this moment, as Jesus gives thanks at the table, the intimate relationship between God the Father and God the Son stands out. As Jesus gives thanks, he is pointing to another time when he became the sign and the seal for us. Now, when all the people were baptized, and when Jesus also had been baptized, he was praying. Then the heavens opened, and the Holy Spirit descended on him in bodily form like a dove. And a voice came from heaven saying, "You are my beloved Son. With you I am well pleased." Now, in the upper room, around this table, with this cup, with this bread, the beloved Son of God gives thanks to his Father for this Passover meal. Scripture tells us, and he took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it, and he gave it to them, saying, "This is my body, which is given to you. Do this in remembrance of me." This is present tense and even future tense. See, the disciples were expecting that Jesus would be speaking in past tense. They thought he would be thanking God for the unblemished lamb that was provided for their ancestors back in Egypt. Jesus is now saying, "This is my body." Not that lamb. "This is my body that is broken for you." Jesus continues. He says, "Do this in remembrance of me." Jesus is saying that he is the sign. He is the seal. They are in the presence of God the Savior. This cup that is poured out for you is a new covenant of my blood. Often in our high school Wednesday night Bible study, we refer to Revelation chapter 21, verse 5. "And the one who is seated on the throne said, 'See, I am making all things new.'" In our Bible study, we note that Jesus is on the throne, and the scripture does not say that Jesus is making all new things. Rather, he is saying he's making all things new. Here in this scripture, Jesus is fulfilling this once again. Jesus does not just end this past covenant and start over with something completely different. Jesus says, "This is a new covenant." He's saying, "I am fulfilling, I am completing, I am accomplishing the old covenant." Jesus is saying, "I am the Passover. My body will be broken for you. My blood shed on a wooden post for you. I am the unblemished lamb. I am the rescuer." Why? Why is Jesus willing to become the unblemished sacrificial lamb? Jesus is sharing the same message with his disciples that he received from the Father. He's sharing it with those who are at the table. Jesus is saying, you are my beloved, with you I am well pleased. That's the new covenant. We are heirs to the kingdom of God. We are children of God. We are marked and sealed. We are the beloved of God the Father. We are therefore invited to join Jesus and to give thanks for this bread and for this cup at the Lord's table. Jesus is the Passover of the past, of the present, and of the future. The new covenant is in Jesus Christ alone. Jesus in Scripture continues, he says, but behold, at the very table where grace is extended, where thanksgiving is being celebrated, is the hand of him who betrays. Jesus says, this has been determined by the Father. Jesus is giving a very important message. He said, be assured, I am in control. All that is happening is the Father's will. He's saying, remember what I told you. In the future, I will take this Passover meal again in the kingdom of God. He's saying, I am sovereign even over this hand that is at this table that I know will betray me. But I am sovereign. I am the Lord. Tonight, this special night, as we gather here and online in this sanctuary, as we receive the bread and the cup, may we hear the truth of the Savior. You are forgiven. Go ahead and put your name there. Don't we need to hear that? You are the beloved. You are forgiven. That's why we can celebrate. That's why we can rejoice. That's why we come to the table with thanksgiving. Because God Himself, Emmanuel, at the table, says to us, you are the beloved. At the table, He gives us a visible sign of the invisible grace. You are the beloved. You are forgiven. Thanks be to God. Amen.
Crime was the love he showed, and I'm the one to blame. I caused all this pain. He gave himself. Thank you. brought me love that only He could give. I brought Him cause to cry, and though He taught me how to live, I taught Him how to die. Instead, He walked right through the gate and then on up the hill. And as He fell beneath the weight, He cried, "Father,
you truly are the beloved. Jesus loves you so much. And as the ones who are loved by Him, I'd invite you to stand together as we enter into this wonderful meal. The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Lift up your hearts.
Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give Him thanks.
It is right and a good and joyful thing always and everywhere to give thanks to you, Father Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth. Worthy are you, our Lord and God, to receive glory and honor and power through Jesus Christ our Lord. Having loved His own who were in the world, He loved them to the end. And on the night before He suffered, He instituted these holy mysteries, that we, receiving the benefits of his passion and resurrection, might be partakers of his divine nature. Therefore, we praise you, joining our voices with angels and archangels and with all the company of heaven who forever proclaim,
"Holy, holy, holy is the Lord God Almighty, who was and is and come. Worthy are you, our Lord and God, to receive glory and honor and power and majesty now and forevermore."
Amen. Please be seated. It is a privilege to gather together and to confirm our covenant vows of love and loyalty to both Christ and to his church as we eat together in communion with one another. Just a few words of instruction. In a moment, Menda and Bob will come to the center aisle and they will dismiss folks from either side. And we'll have two stations tonight, and you may come forward down the center aisle and receive the elements and then return to your seats by the side aisle. And then once we have these two sections served, then Bob and Menda will come over to both of the transepts and dismiss each of those areas also to take communion together. If you are in need of a gluten-free option, this plate right here is gluten-free. And if you need communion brought to you at the very end, just raise your hand, catch Jeff's eye, and he and Joe will come and bring communion to your location instead. But let's pray. Lord, we are so grateful for what is before us this day that represents you, your very presence with us. We thank you for your grace. We thank you for your mercy. We thank you for the extent you have gone to extend both your grace and mercy to us. And so, Lord, bless these elements and bless those who partake of it. Draw us together as your family as we gather for this meal together now. We ask in Jesus' name, amen. For I receive from the Lord what I also pass on to you. The Lord Jesus, on the night that he was betrayed, took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, "This is my body, which is broken for you. Do this in remembrance of me." Same way, after supper, he took the cup, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this whenever you drink it in remembrance of me. For whenever you eat this bread and drink this cup, you are proclaiming the Lord's death until he comes." Hallelujah, our Passover lamb has been sacrificed for us. Therefore, let us keep the feast. Amen.
Let us pray. Lord God Almighty, Lord Jesus Christ, we thank you, Lord, for this table, for this cup. We thank you, Lord, for your invitation to sit at this table with you, to receive this Passover meal, knowing that you are our Passover. You are the unblemished Lamb. We thank you, Lord, for your love, for calling us your beloved, because in you we have forgiveness. So, Lord, we say thanks. Thanks, Lord, for this cup. We give thanks for this bread. Amen. I'd like to invite you, let us continue to worship as we sing together the hymn that is in your bulletin. Please remain seated.
Hear now the high priestly prayer prayed by Jesus for the sake of his people from John 17. When Jesus had spoken these words, he lifted up his eyes to heaven and said, "Father, the hour has come. Glorify your Son, that the Son may glorify you, since you have given him authority over all flesh, to give eternal life to all whom you have given him. And this is eternal life, that they know you, the only true God, and Jesus Christ, whom you have sent. I glorified you on earth, having accomplished the work that you gave me to do. And now, Father, glorify me in your own presence with the glory that I had with you before the world existed." I have manifested your name to the people whom you gave me out of the world. Yours they were, and you gave them to me, and they have kept your word. Now they know that everything that you have given me is from you. For I have given them the words that you gave me, and they have received them and have come to know in truth that I came from you, and they have believed that you sent me. I am praying for them. I am not praying for the world, but for those whom you have given me, for they are yours. All mine are yours, and yours are mine, and I am glorified in them. And I am no longer in the world, but they are in the world, and I am coming to you. Holy Father, keep them in your name, which you have given me, that they may be one, even as we are one. While I was with them, I kept them in your name, which you have given me. I have guarded them, and not one of them has been lost except the son of destruction, that the scriptures might be fulfilled. But now I am coming to you, and these things I speak in the world, that they may have my joy fulfilled in themselves. I have given them your word, and the world has hated them because they are not of the world, just as I am not of the world. I do not ask that you take them out of the world, but that you keep them from the evil one. They are not of the world, just as I am not of the world. Sanctify them in the truth. Your word is truth. As you sent me into the world, so I have sent them into the world. And for their sake, I consecrate myself, that they also may be sanctified in truth. I do not ask for these only, but also for those who will believe in me through their word, that they may all be one, just as you, Father, are in me, and I in you, that they may also be in us, so that the world may believe that you have sent me. The glory that you have given me, I have given to them, that they may be one, even as we are one. I in them, and you in me. That they may become perfectly one, so that the world may know that you sent me and loved them even as you love me. Father, I desire that they also, whom you have given me, may be with me where I am, to see my glory that you have given me because you loved me before the foundation of the world. O righteous Father, even though the world does not know you, I know you, and these know you, have sent me. I made known to them your name, and I will continue to make it known, that the love with which you have loved me may be in them, and I in them.